All right, here we go. All right, welcome to the Teaching a Rockstar podcast. And on today's episode, we have my pal Samantha Jo Berry. Watch out. And Samantha, in my mind, I say Samantha, but when it comes out of my mouth, I say Samantha Jo. Uh-huh. So what do most people say?
So people ask me all the time. They're like, what do people call you? One of my favorite things about my name is everybody takes a very personal approach with it. And so, I mean, people call me all kinds of things. Sam, Samantha, Samantha Jo, SJ, SJB, like... And for me, I like it all. So it's just really whatever somebody feels comfortable with.
It's social justice warrior.
That's what it is.
All right. Samantha Jo is the journalism teacher at Bridgeland High School in Cy-Fair ISD. My district alma mater that I used to teach at. And I'm not sure how we met. Maybe she can remind me. And I'll say the first part. She can say the second half. She is the president-elect of the...
Texas Association of Journalism Educators.
And that is fancy. I'm not sure what that is, but that sounds really fancy. And so President-elect Samantha Jo Berry on the show today, Teaching a Rockstar podcast. Here we go. Let's do this. And I'll put some bubble music in there.
Yeah.
All right. So take me back because I have no idea, man. How do we meet?
I remember exactly, actually.
When, where, how?
So you came, when I was working at Cy Creek, you came mm-hmm. and did it was one of those days where it was like just teachers on campus, and our good friend Amy King.
I remember.
Yes. And
I got it. And the junior high from across the street was there.
Yes, exactly. Okay. And I walked, like, I saw you in the hallway, and I think you were on your way out, actually. And I just walked up and I said, hey, that was really great. Thank you so much. And then we just started talking. Uh-huh. And then from that point, you came to my classroom, and it was just like we were friends after that.
The buddyship was born.
It was. It was, like, so fast.
All right. I don't know how you do it, compliments, so just sit and take it. Here's what I loved about visiting your classroom. I loved how... so much about it. Like, it's hard for people that don't teach. And, I'm learning more and more of those people listen to this for some reason, but people that do teach get it. And people that don't teach have no idea what I'm talking about. But what I love about how kids are just popping in and popping out and wanted to update you on their day just because they're passing by your room and wanted to see if the shirts were in and wanted to see if the computer screens were really coming in, like you said they were. And they were just so into that, family that you created for them at that school. And like that alone, when I see that, when I feel that, I know like amazing instruction's happening.
Well, thanks.
Yeah.
I appreciate that. For me, I really want to create a place on campus where kids feel safe. And, you know, and we talk about that a lot. I mean, and especially in education, you know, we talk about safe spaces all the time. But I actually heard someone say something this summer that really made a difference to me, that it wasn't just creating a safe space, it was creating a brave space. And for me, like I want them to feel like it's their space. And so they decorate the room. They have ownership of it. They have that choice in there of how much they plug in. And it's very obvious to kids when they're on the fence about plugging in, when they see those kids that are in the room all the time and they come in, they stop in to say, hey, and things like that, that, wow, if I just really plug in, this is going to be a really good place for me. And so actually that was a really high compliment. I super appreciate it.
Yeah, for sure. And I love that. I want to make a shirt. That whole safety to bravery, like safety really is the prerequisite for bravery.
Exactly.
I love it.
You really cannot feel courageous if on some level you don't feel like someone has your back. Because I guess in a lot of ways I feel like courage, is it really courage if you're just flinging yourself in there without feeling any kind of safety? That's sometimes just reckless. So I think courage really is always born from feeling some level, even if it's very small level of safety or just someone has your back. And I had told my kids this year that was going to be a phrase we said in our classroom all this year was, I got your back. And just saying that all the time, you know, just repeating it as much as we can.
I love it, man. There's so much of that. Like that. Here's the thing is, I think we underestimate like the power of those types of, like when we come up with a theme and like when the kids buy in, mm-hmm. you know, it really changes everything.
Oh, yeah.
Like they really get it. And, you know, I just brought this up on yesterday's podcast. People probably get tired of me talking about it, but it's such a great evidence and proof that it works is when Jeff Springer was at Magnolia High School, and he had this whole thing, VCL everything, VCL mm-hmm. shirts, VCL wristbands, valued. You're valuable, you're complete, and you're loved. He wanted everybody to know that.
Yeah.
Like, you're complete, you're significant, you're valuable, you have meaning everywhere you go. Mm-hmm. You're complete. Like, it's all in there.
Yeah.
You're the way you showed up, you have everything inside of you. We're just trying to flip on the light so you can see it and bring it out of you.
Mm-hmm.
And you're loved. And he would say it, and when people show up on campus, like, wow, man, these kids really bought in. But what they don't see is the years and years and years of consistency of constantly preaching it. Every time he's on the microphone, on the announcements, every pep rally, every time he's in front of kids, mm-hmm. every shirt they make, every hashtag, every post on Twitter, everything, hashtag VCL. And yeah, like that. But it took forever, it seems like, for that to really become a part of it. But when it did, it's done.
That's huge.
That's the culture.
Yeah. I love that he included complete in there. Cause like just the minute you said that, I felt like, all these like neurons in my head were like connecting and stuff.
Right.
Because I even wonder in my own classroom, have I ever reminded kids that they are complete as they are right now? Because we actually see it all the time. We see it in adults all the time that they think, well, I can't do that until I fix this, or I can't do that until maybe I become this. I was talking to a friend not that long ago, and she really wants to get more involved, and she wants to teach like some workshops and things like that. And she just has such a powerful voice, and she's such a valuable person. But, you know, people hold themselves back because they think, well, I need to become a little bit better of a public speaker. Or I need to do this, or I need to learn this, or do this before I, and it's like, no, just you are complete as you are. I just think that's huge.
You know, that whole little bit better of a public speaker thing, here's the fascinating part is when I see, I'll go to things and I'll see guys and women that are crazy polished.
Yeah.
Polished in terms of their hairdo, their makeup, their business suit, their shoes are polished, their speech, their mm-hmm. intonation, the inflection, the gestures are rehearsed. And I can respect it.
Yeah.
Because to rehearse that, wow. But that ain't my thing, right?
No, mine either.
A little rough around the edges. Mm-hmm. And like, I know where we're going to start. I know where we're going to finish. And how we're going to get there, I don't know. We'll see what happens today.
Yeah.
But that's what I love about people getting put in public is I would much rather see somebody get up there and just be vulnerable.
Yeah.
And just what I call emotionally naked and just everything. Here we go, man. I'm not sure how it's going to go. I'm going to be passionate and give you everything that I have. Like, those are the days where I find someone on the stage like, golly, man, I need to get back to that.
Yeah. No, listen, I love the mess. Okay. All my heroes are messy. Like, they're messy people. Like, when I think of all the people that speak life into me, they bring their mess out in the open, and they're not afraid to stumble over their words, and it's just so authentic and genuine. And like, I really respect Brene Brown. Like, Brene Brown's my Oprah. I tell people that all the time. That's my Oprah.
She's got that messy thing figured out.
She does, and she embraces it, and she's not afraid to admit it. Jen Hatmaker, the same thing. Like, mm-hmm. I think there's so much power in leaning into mess and allowing it to be something you work from instead of something you're avoiding. And I think there's a lot. I think we have to teach our kids that all the time as well. They're so afraid of messy because they think messy is negative. No, it's really not. You're never going to avoid mess. And so I think if you just lean into it, really cool things happen.
And I think everybody's like that. Like, anytime I see, not just a speaker, but anybody who's like a little too polished, like that family photo is a little bit much, man.
Yeah.
Or like, I'll see Ted Cruz with his family or something where, you know, there's a huge pile of mess in that living room of people, you know, yelling at each other, or can't find the remote.
Yeah.
The dog peed on the rug again.
Exactly. Because you want to see the humanity in people.
That's why I think podcasts are so huge. Because like, that's an opportunity for people. Like, there's no, you know, corporate sponsors. I mean, we have tiny ones, but they don't care what I say, you know, and you can just be absolutely completely used yourself. Hey, here's the other thing. I was thinking, I guess too many thoughts going on at once, but when you said complete, that when I would see Springer in his school talk about that, that's where things shifted for me like 6 or 7 years ago when I witnessed this whole thing, because when I was on stage, I do my thing. And people are like, oh my God, that was so good. That was so great. And you did this for me and you did that for me. And thank you so much. And then I would believe it. And that gets down, that creates a very dangerous slope, because if you believe that, the next time you go on Twitter and somebody posts, I think Hal Bowman's a big POS and he was horrible and what a waste of my time, you got to believe that too.
Yeah.
So what the complete thing did for me was it helped me realize when somebody said, man, that was already in that teacher for whatever reason. Mm-hmm. I was able, just by pure chance, to put some words together in an order with an authentic moment in my life where they were able to access what was already. I didn't create anything in that person. It was already there. And yeah. now they were able to see it for themselves more clearly than they've seen it before. That's it.
Yeah.
And like when I give it up to them, it's not me, it's that person, changes everything.
Yeah. No, I think what you said it is really profound, especially about you've got to believe the negative too. Like when people are like, oh, that wasn't for me. That just didn't work for me.
Yeah.
I think we often tell people too, oh, well, you know, forget the haters. And there's value to that as well. But it is important to say, wow, I mean, I didn't connect with that person. And also not to let it like ruin your day or anything like that. But also you gotta believe it. And I think that's.
And that's fine.
Also, I hope nobody's like trolling you on Twitter, because
I've had that in the past.
No,
I have some dudes like I had this one guy like his email or secret email. I figured out who he was, and he was horrible.
Oh my God, what's he was wrong relentless. With
I don't know. He said the most terrible things, and it was terrible. He's probably listening right now.
I hope so, sir. Get right, like please, like go work on.
Know.
Please go see a counselor. Counseling is awesome. Please go take care of yourself. No, all these people that are like keyboard warriors, you know, like they're like, well, I'm gonna tell them what's what on the internet, and I'm like, I just want a shirt that says, really, no one cares. Like what you say on the internet, like they just don't care. I'm always baffled when I hear things like that. A friend of mine shared an experience. She taught a workshop yesterday, shared an experience that someone had kind of just like come at her and stuff. And I was like, why? Like, what do you gain from that? I will never understand. I've never, I've sat in plenty of workshops and plenty of even church services and been like, I don't like that, you know, but I've never
gone
up to them and been like, well, I have to tell you something. Like, I've never done that.
So bizarre.
It's so weird.
I know.
It's so strange.
I don't get it. But it's the same. I don't know. And but I think at the same time, like that dude, he was really underestimating how immature I am.
Yeah.
Because once I saw him, I went, oh, you got to be kidding me.
Yeah.
And like, if I'm just really immature when it comes to conflict. Capable.
I'm so petty. So we have that in common. I'm also like, you were like, I found out who he was. I'm like, yeah, that's what I'd have done too.
Yeah.
I'm like, I should have gone into the CIA, because I'm like, oh, I will find you.
Right.
No, nothing's secret on the internet. Nothing is a secret.
And here's the funny thing. A friend of mine is a famous musician, and he was, he's had this issue in the past, obviously, with people opening fake accounts in his name and putting up crazy stuff. And I was like,
wild.
And I said, well, here's the thing, man. Like, I have what he has sent me. I know who he is. Mm-hmm. And I know where he works at a school. Mm-hmm. And it was a private school. And I have the names of all the board members and the donors.
Yeah.
And I have the headmasters. I could ruin his life.
And
I really want to. So here's why. When he started making fun of my teachers that would come to my... And he would make fun of posts online. I remember specifically one teacher posted about how she was asking around for firewood because now it's getting cold in her state. Yeah. And a lot of her students, that's how they heat their house in the mountains. And this dude worked at a school, it was like $20,000 a semester for kids to go. And he's making fun of this teacher rounding up wood for her. I know.
Oh my God.
And I'm like, dude, I'm going to ruin his life. And he goes, well, here's the thing you have to remember. He has a full-time job and a life, and he has time for this. Imagine if he has nothing going on except for you.
you. Give him another job. Yeah. Give him more responsibility. Don't let him free on the internet.
So I finally blocked him in every way. Like, he can't email me and all that stuff. And I don't know, man.
Man, I really hope he listens to this. And all I want to say is...
He'll be back in. He'll be back in if he hears this. Like, I was getting to him.
No, yeah. You have him as a guest.
I would.
Just make this a personal invite. Like... Please come on my podcast. We'll 2020 warp your voice so people won't find you, since anonymity is so important to you, sir. But
that was my secret plan, because I had a workshop in the city years ago and I really thought about just showing up at the school.
Yeah.
Knocking on the door.
I am here to see so-and-so.
Hey, brother.
I can just hear like the like the Twilight Zone music or like creepy music, like you know, and he'd probably just like close the door in your face and run away.
Or, you know, I thought about leaving him. I had his, phone number too, because it was posted on something.
Yeah.
And like leaving him that med, you know, I have a very particular set of skills.
I'm not against this idea. I said it. I'm petty. So I'm like, I'm always like 2 inches, like just 2 seconds away from making a very petty decision. So
I will find you.
Send him lots of swag.
Right.
Just be like, just send him tons of stuff all the time. Sign him up for a bunch of newsletters. It's all about, have you found your inner peace?
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, all right. So let me get into this, because here's what I want to know. I remember speaking with you, and you went to a smaller school. You were from a more of a rural community.
Super small.
Yeah. And how many kids in a graduating class?
There was 12 people in my graduating class.
All right, so we have a valedictorian and a top 10%, basically the same person.
Is the same person. Right. And it wasn't me, and my mom is still bitter about it.
where were you, in the top 4 or 5?
I was in the top 3.
There you go.
It was like a battle for like number 2.
And hold on, you're telling me you barely made the top 25%.
I've been barely. I'm not that smart. Like, you're letting me educate your children. But no, it was like my class was really competitive. So the top like 4 of us were just kind of like just toe for toe the entire time. You know, we took all the same classes. We, when our test grades would come out, they'd almost be like just within points of one another. So I remember when it came down to just to calculating the valedictorian and the salutatorian, the valedictorian won by a couple points, but between me and the other kid that got salutatorian, it was like decimal points.
Yeah.
And it, we were all very competitive. And, you know, at the time I didn't love that. I hated kind of running this race the whole time. And I mean, cause I ran this race from kindergarten through, senior year with these people. And, but looking back now, I'm like, wow, going to a really small school obviously means there's a lot of things you don't have. So we did not have like advanced placement classes. So it was just all, everybody was in the same class. I mean, you had the same math teacher all 4 years of high school. Like, you, I mean, there were just, there's a lot of benefits to it, but there's a lot, there are disadvantages as well. And for all of us who were very academically motivated and very much had high hopes and big dreams and were very studious, it was kind of hard for us to, we were bored a lot. And so I think back now that really having that competitive edge between the 4 of us was exactly what we needed. And we're actually all teachers now.
Really?
All 4 of us.
That is the amazing thing, because I taught in small schools, and when I go, it is shocking the number of, when you look at percentage of kids that actually go to college and get the degree, what percentage of those are teachers? It's always astronomically high compared to other schools.
Mm-hmm.
A lot, and the reason is because that's their life and they loved it. And
the whole
oftentimes,
town revolves around the school.
It is the town.
Yeah.
And a lot of them want to come back. Not all of them, but a lot of them want to come back. They don't think they do, but they come back.
Right. One of us, of the 4 of us, one actually does teach at where we grew up. He was a great teacher. And then the other two teach pretty close in a town kind of nearby. They're actually married. So that's also a fun fact.
Of course they are.
Yeah, they dated all through high school. And then
that's what I
said
about the small towns. If you find somebody you're not all that related to, marry them.
I know, I tease the kids all the time. They're like, were you popular in high school? I'm like, absolutely not. People dated their cousins before they dated me, which is not true. But
it's close.
I mean, it was pretty close. which always they laugh and they're like horrified. But, you know, there are more kids in the school I teach in the one building than in my entire hometown.
Yep.
Like by several, like you could fit 4 of my hometowns worth of people in that school. And, so it's always, it's sometimes, especially in the beginning, it was like, wow, I work in a little city. Like when you think about it, I work in a little city. And so it's, you know, it's an adjustment.
You know, that's the other thing I tell people. It's not like a city. It is. Like, if you think about, we have healthcare, we have food services, we have transportation, we have, you know, entertainment. I mean, it is. And to run, and there's the principals, the mayor.
Yeah.
And we're trying to pull this thing off, and you know, the assistant principal, we have, you know, security, there's police officers, a judge, and the jury.
We have literally everything you need.
Yeah. And we're running it. And we open up the city early in the morning, we close it down late at night, and we do it again the next day. And in your town, it was one of those schools where the reason they had organizations and teams is because everybody participated. That's the only way you can do it.
Oh, I mean, absolutely. When I was in high school, just to give people an idea, so I played basketball for a couple of years. I was terrible. So, because anyone in my hometown that listens to this might, well, she, quote, air quotes, played basketball. Right. She was not good. So I did basketball. I did track for a little while. Obviously, the field events, not the running events. And then I was FFA president, and I was in theater, and I did UIL, and I went to Girls State 1 year. And it was, you know, and this is not, it's not, like you said, it's not bragging that people do all this stuff. We weren't really collectors of things. It was, you had to. If something was going to survive, everyone had to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Here's the other thing I love about it. Recently, a gentleman said this to me. I can't remember where I was, but I can't remember. But he were talking about the difference between suburban kids, you know, schools like where you teach now, and small kid and like small town kids. And he was talking about, you know, there's really not as there's no real consequences for suburban school kids on certain levels. And I was trying to figure out what he's talking about. He goes like, well, like, if you have a kid at your, you know, 5A high school in suburbs doesn't want to play, so don't play.
Yeah.
Who cares? But if that happens at a small school, we ain't having a team.
No. No, I mean, so we played six-man football. Like, we didn't even play, I mean, I guess, quote-unquote, real football.
Right.
And when that happens, like, if a kid would fail, like, you were totally screwed. And so, yeah, it's... Right. It's a numbers game all the time in small schools.
And you'd say, you know, in terms of consequences, like if a kid in the suburbs doesn't do their chore, well, you know what? The recycling truck is coming back in another couple of weeks. Big deal. But out here in this town, where he was telling me, if somebody doesn't do their chore, something dies.
Yeah.
An animal dies.
Yeah.
Crops die. Something is going to go really bad if a kid doesn't handle his responsibilities.
Right.
So it's a whole different thing, man.
Because we had really big responsibilities. You know, and I tell this story a lot because people seem to enjoy it when I'm like, really, I just think it's a wild thing. So, you know, I grew up in a rural area in the country, 80 acres of land. And my parents, for my 13th birthday, took me to take out a loan. Like, I took out a young farmer's loan and bought my own goat ranch and owned it. Like, just to give you an idea of what small town West Texas is
right,
like.
Let's get her started.
Yeah. So, like, when you said, like, if somebody doesn't do their chores, something dies. Like, well, yeah, when I had 50 to 60 goats that I was responsible for, like, if I didn't feed them, they died.
Yeah.
You know? Or if I left the gate open and the coyotes got in, like, something died. Which, that's not necessarily what our kids here experience.
No. You're going to be fine.
Yeah. Like, it's
we
fine.
Have services for you.
We'll just hire someone to do that. Yeah. Like, no one's delivering your groceries out there. We couldn't even get pizza delivered to our house. Like, we would have to call it in and go pick it up. Pizza didn't even come out there, so there was no delivery service.
Right.
Half the time, people knocked over our mailbox, and our mail would fly everywhere, like, with their tractors. Yeah. Like,
that's funny. Like, in the suburbs, people try to do that as a fun. There it just happens because it's a tractor.
Yeah, I remember my dad was, like, so mad about our mailbox getting knocked over the time that he built this, like, giant steel mailbox. It's still out there. But it is, I mean, if you hit it, it's going to mess something up.
Yeah.
Like, he was like, it's going to hurt them. Whenever they hit it, they're going to know they hit it.
Did you love it growing up in the small town thing?
No. No. I did it. I was definitely, and I say this not to be like, no, I hate it. I was definitely that kid that wanted out, for sure.
Yeah.
And to the point that I was like a brat. And I remember in high school, there was, you know, they do like the senior superlatives. Well, there was like some like underground list, and I actually don't know what all was on it. But a guy that I went to high school with was like, oh yeah, everybody voted you snobbiest. And I'm like... As a 31-year-old woman, right. I'm like, well, that sounds about right. Like, I was pretty snobby. And I really, like, it's not like I don't know. Maybe I thought I was better than everybody else. I don't know. If I did, there's no defending that. I'm not proud of it. But I just.
You maybe just wanted something different.
I did. I just.
And that seemed.
a city. Like, I wanted to know what that was like. And so
I think that for a kid, that's like the natural response. If somebody wants something different than you, obviously the only reason you would think that is because you think you're better than us.
Right.
And from the mind of a kid.
Yeah.
Rather than just want, man, I just want apples and you want oranges. That's
yeah, exactly. I just wanted some, I wanted to see the world. That was a big thing. That's always been a big thing for me, is I wanted a passport and I wanted to see the world and I wanted to go. And even when we would have family vacations and, you know, my parents would like plan stuff, I'd be like, well, are we going to go to a city? Like, that's all I wanted was to go to a city, because there was something about them that just, you know, fulfilled me, I guess, in a way that I didn't feel fulfilled. I mean, I was just bored.
And now that you're in a city, do you take advantage of it? Like, do you go to museums and
yes,
do the whole city
all
thing?
The time. Yeah. I love it. So I never thought I would ever move to Houston. You know, we came to Houston a lot growing up with the stock show. So we would bring our animals and stuff. And I do remember every time we would come, like, my parents would be like, oh, this place, oh my gosh, it's the worst. And I remember thinking, it's the worst. Like, why would anybody move to Houston? And I got an opportunity and I really just needed out of West Texas. And so I was like, whatever, I'll move there for a year. If I hate it, I'll leave. And I've lived here 6 years now and I love it. And I do take full advantage of it. Museums, concerts, Astros games, whatever I can do. Like, I want to go and I want to do and I want to see all of it.
And you got a passport.
And I got a passport. Yeah. And so since moving here, I've been to, with students, I've taken students on trips, which I love it. And people are always like, you're absolutely crazy.
Why I'm just thinking right now, you're absolutely insane.
I love it.
There's no way.
There is something so magic. And you know what it is? It's because I was that kid that just wanted to see the world. And taking kids around the country and watching them, it's like I'm gifting 15-year-old me what I needed, you know? And so with
that's kids, why I don't do it, because I was a kid who was going to do something really horrible. And I'm not going to be that teacher taking that kid.
Right. No. I thankfully have never had anything bad happen. But we've been to England and France and Germany. And this summer we went to Krakow, Prague, Munich, and Switzerland. And it's huge. I love it. And so it's, moving to Houston changed my life for all the right reasons.
Yeah. And so when you were in high school, at this point in your small town, were you thinking, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do this teaching thing?
Oh, no. If you would have told 15-year-old me that I'd have been a teacher, I would have laughed straight in your face.
Really?
Oh, I mean, I was the queen of saying, I would never do so much for so little. Like, I was the queen of that. And how I became a teacher was I went to Texas Tech, Reckham, and got a degree in agricultural communications, which was a super great program. I really loved it. I learned so much about communications through them. And, I was in FFA, and I have, you know, a soft spot in my heart for agriculture and all that. And so I graduated and I couldn't find a job. You know, graduating in 2010 was not the
What type of job were you going to get with that? What were you thinking?
I wanted to work for magazines. I mean, one thing about me is that I've always known I wanted to be a journalist. My favorite show growing up was 2020. Like, I was
me
sure.
Me too.
I love that show.
60 Minutes, 2020, Texas Hill Country Reporter.
Yes. Oh my gosh, Texas Hill Country. My mom got to meet him not that long ago, and I'm so jealous. I know, I'm so jealous. And I think it was the Texas Hill Country Reporter. Yeah, I think it was him.
Yeah, that guy.
I don't know. She may be like, no, it wasn't him. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure it was. But I loved it. I loved shows like that. And I knew that that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to tell stories. And so I graduated and I could not find a job in a magazine to save my life. I just could not find anything. And so I was at the dentist's office, and I've had the same dentist since I was 5. And he was like, you know, cleaning my teeth or whatever. And he goes, so your mom says you haven't found a job yet. I was like,
small town, baby. Yeah,
thanks. I was like, no, I haven't found a job yet. And so this was actually in a town about an hour away where my mom actually grew up. Mm-hmm. And so we had lived there till I was about 4. And that's when we moved to the really small town. But he was like, you know, there's a journalism teacher job opening here and you should take it. And I said, no. I was like, no, thank you. And he didn't like that answer. So he calls the principal anyways, who he went to church with, small town. And the principal called me and invited me in for an interview. And I was a total brat in the entire interview. I was like, I don't know anything about teaching. I don't care. And I just remember at the end, he goes, well, do you like a challenge? And I said, yeah. And he goes, cool, you got the job. was like,
that's how it works in small town.
Yeah, I mean, he just needed a teacher.
For
and he
sure.
was like, you know, she doesn't, you know, people like her, I guess, because, right. you know, my friend who's the dentist, like, suggested her.
That's how it goes. So
that's how it goes.
You have a record?
Yeah.
You're hired. Yes, let's like, go.
You ever killed a man? Like,
you, look, no. Sounds good to us. Right, good to classroom.
Like, she doesn't look, you know, threatening in any way. And it was the hardest 3 years of my life. And I hated it for 3 years. People ask me all the time, they're like, man, you must have loved teaching instantly. I'm like, oh, God, no. I cried every day for 3 years. I'd never been depressed until then.
Yeah.
And it was like real depression.
What
it, was hard.
What size school was it?
It was about 1,000 kids. So it was,
oh, this is, so you're teaching journalism, yearbook, what else?
Newspaper, yearbook, journalism, speech. And photojournalism. Nope, just
it.
Journalism.
Right.
I really lucked out there. To do that. I mean, that's the thing. I'm only certified in journalism. I actually, you know, it's all I can teach. It's all anybody wants me to teach. Let's be clear about that. But I just was miserable for 3 years. But that first year, I walked into my principal's office and I said, hey, listen, here's the deal. If I don't get some help, I'm going to quit. Like, I can't, I've never not been able to do something and I have no idea what I'm doing.
Yeah.
And he said, okay. And so he sends me to Dallas to meet up with this guy. And I'm just like amazed at how this guy runs a classroom. And like, he just knows what he's doing. And he's so cool. And all the kids like him. And I'm kind of like,
you went to a school?
Yeah. I went to a school for 2 days. And jeez. I was like, wow. Like, it was just it was so neat. And, kind of like bonded with him and stuff like that. And I got like kind of more excited. And then he just decided, well, I'm going to mentor this girl, I guess. Mm. Like, and we've been best friends for 10 years.
Is he still doing it?
Yeah.
He's Who still is this doing guy? It.
His name's Leland Millette. He teaches in Mansfield ISD at Legacy High School.
I've been there.
And he is the bomb. Like,
how did your principal know this guy?
So he had taught at this school and he had left
yeah.
and they had moved to Dallas. So he had taught there. I mean, there had been 4 or 5 teachers, I think, between us,
right.
that nothing had worked out. Like, you know what I mean? And we just met. And I remember I actually asked him this summer because I'm helping one of my former students who's now teaching. And I was like, well, how'd you know that I could do this? Like, I was miserable and I was such a brat. And he goes, I knew that you were just crazy enough.
Yeah.
Like, he was like, you were just crazy enough to make this work. And for 3 years, every year when I tried to quit, he'd go, no, let's give it one more year. No. Let's great. Try again. And then at the end of 3 years when I was like, no, this is really the end for me. He was like, let's try a different school. And he helped me get the job in Houston. And in that fourth year of teaching, that first year in Houston, I called him and I said, I love to teach.
Oh, I love it.
I love it. I was like, I feel so complete in this and fulfilled. And so, yeah, people ask all the time, like, you know, why are you a teacher? How'd this happen? I was like, well, I was very reluctant, but I had somebody who believed in me when I really had no idea how to believe in myself. And because of that, I'm a teacher. And,
you know, yeah. I think there's so many ingredients in that. One is you got to the place you wanted to be, which is the city. Mm-hmm. You found a school possibly that you've envisioned in your mind. Like, what if we had this and we had resources and that?
Yeah, exactly.
And you had staff and new interesting people and people like in your mind, these are the people I wanted to live with and grow mm-hmm. with, you know, as growing up. And I think that, you know, when opportunity met this vision that you had in your mind growing up, that's what the magic was made. And here's what I love. I love that your principal had the thought to send you to see what it looks like.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Because I can tell you this a number of times, maybe every time, like when mm-hmm. I was teaching, when I was a band director at a mm-hmm. tiny little 1A school by myself, mm-hmm. I really thought we were great. Until my next job, I went to a 5A school that was like a perennial competitor at the state level. Mm-hmm. And I heard that band play one note and realized, oh my God, I have no idea what I'm doing.
That's me too.
Like, I didn't know.
Yeah.
You can't do better until you know better.
Right.
And then the same thing when I was teaching PALS at Cy Springs. Mm-hmm. I thought we were great until I went to Cy-Fair and saw what Coble was doing in his group. I went, oh my God, I had no idea it can get to that level.
Yeah.
And once I knew better, mm-hmm. that, like, raised my own expectation because I wasn't out there. And I think that maybe that's one of the things in education we just don't do well enough that other professions do all the time.
Yeah.
Like, if you have a sales team, you're going to take all your people on your sales team and make them go travel with the very best men and women in the sales organization
yeah.
to see what they do. But we just don't have those opportunities as educators.
Well, and I think the best people in any field will never categorize themselves as the best.
They don't even know it.
They don't know it. You know, it's to be the best, I think requires you to always realize that there's someone better than you out there. You know, that the best is just an illusion.
Right.
And that and that's a problem in any field, but in education as well, that people will say, well, I'm the best teacher.
Right.
You know, and it's like, no, like nobody is the best teacher, and you can always learn and you can always do better. And so I think that's a really, that's a mentality people have to avoid, is to think that there's not someone better than them out there that they can learn from.
Yeah. And I you know, my little morning quotes, I do, I think one of them at one point, and, I had this realization, you know, hanging out with these teachers across the nation, and when I say the best, like, mm-hmm. I'm thinking, like, when I mean the best, like, I can see that they're clearly the most passionate and therefore oftentimes the most effective. That's what I mean.
Yeah.
And the one thing they all have in common is they're always looking for a way to be more effective.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it's crazy.
They're the people who take the notes in the workshops.
Yeah.
They're the people who come up afterwards and say, would you share that resource with me? And I mean, even sometimes when I teach workshops and someone comes up to me and says, will you share that resource? I'm like, why would you ever need my resource?
Right, yeah.
You're amazing, you know? But it's that, okay, I may be good at my job, but that doesn't mean I can't be better.
Yeah.
And so, no, that's huge. And going back to my principal at that time, sending me to work with him, you know, that was huge. Like, he didn't have to do that. He didn't have to, he could have just told me to suck it up and, you know, try harder or whatever, but he moved mountains to make sure that I got some help that I needed.
Yeah.
And I mean, that was what I needed to survive in that job. And I would not say that I was good those first 3 years.
You know, that try harder thing, that's such a common, that's such a common statement in education. And what I've always said, you know, when I'm looking around, I find the most effective teachers and really the most effective organizations, whether it's a district or a school, one of the things that they have in common, like the reason, because they're all oftentimes the first to give up.
Yeah.
And here's what I mean. Like, they see something that's not working for them and they're out. Let's do something different. Rather than, okay, we're gonna do harder and more of it and louder. You know?
Yeah.
Even though it's not working, it's not effective at all. Rather than say, okay, that worked for Mansfield High School, it ain't working for Legacy. Let's change it and let's do something completely. That's really where, and often in terms of just individual teachers in the classroom, just because, you know, for Miss Williamson next door, that works for her because that's her.
Yeah.
And that's part of her DNA and her personality and who she is. And she's killing it. And I'm going to try it, but if it doesn't work for me, I'm not going to do harder and more of it.
Right. Because then at some point too, especially like in teaching strategies, kids can tell if something's not authentic to you.
Yeah.
Like, so I kind of call it like the Dead Poets Society effect. Like, they think, well, you know, Robin Williams climbed on a desk, so I'm going to climb on a desk.
Yeah.
And it's like, but sometimes it just doesn't look genuine.
Right.
It looks like, you know, performance art a little bit, and you have to in the classroom just bring you to the table every day because that's what kids want.
Yeah.
If you're quiet, well, then you're probably going to have a quieter instruction. And we don't value that enough in a school building, that sometimes kids really need that teacher who is very chill and is very low key. But we think in that, well, you know, this person's really high energy and kids talk about how much they love them all the time, so that must mean they don't love me. No. You provide something else for them.
Yeah.
And that's something I think we just don't tell teachers enough. We don't affirm teachers enough. So like earlier you said, I give compliments. I hope you're okay with that. My love language is words of affirmation. Like I that's how I receive love. That's how I give it. And I think a lot of times in education, we don't affirm people enough and in the right ways. I don't know that we're intentional enough at saying you provide something for students that they need in a building, and yes, it doesn't look like so-and-so, but that doesn't mean it's not valuable. And I think sometimes even when we're asking teachers to share their strategies, we sometimes need to go to the quieter teachers and say, how do you foster that sense of calmness in your classroom? You know, I've never sat in a session where someone taught me how to foster a sense of calmness in the classroom. And there's something really valuable about that. And so my friend Leland, actually, when you walk into his room, so he's, and we tease him about this, but he's a low talker. Like he really never talks very loud. Like it's like this. And I'm a screamer, you know, like I'm like rah, all the time. But one of the things that struck me when I first met him and sat in his classroom was whenever he would start instruction, he would just start talking like this. he would just start talking. He'd go, okay, well, here, we're going to have a nice day, da, da, da. And, like, kids would have to be quiet to hear him. He never told them to be quiet. He just would start talking. And they would – and every time since then that I've ever been in his classroom, I've always been amazed at the sense of calm and steady that's in there.
Yep.
Because that's really not the vibe in my classroom. It's kind of – it's energetic and a little bit wild and – there's kind of a sense of urgency all the time. Well, in his, there's just this calm, steady, disciplined, happy, really chill environment. And, you know, I think that...
And that's him.
That's him. And
that's why it works.
If he were anything else, it wouldn't work. But if I tried to be that way, it would be so weird.
That's what I always say. Like... You know, and you know, like, you know, that you know, we did a podcast yesterday. It's going to come out before this one with Sarah Cooper. She is on Instagram, Rocky Top Teacher. Mm-hmm. And we talked about that being authentic and who you really are in the classroom. And like, that's what we have left in terms of kids respecting us, mm-hmm. you know, like to be, and like, if I, you know, we've all had that teacher where they can give you the look and raise a left eyebrow.
It's terrible.
And point at you, you know, and that, because that's, but if I tried that with my gangsters, it would like give me the finger. There's no way that would even work because that's not me.
Yeah.
And they know that. And like you and I have similar styles where we kind of have this like 3-ring circus of shenanigans going on and there's the bells about to ring and we got, you know.
Yeah. It's like, everybody quiet. I have to, like 10 more things to say.
But the complete polar opposite is I went and spoke at my daughter's school, which is now my son's school, and their chemistry teacher, the science teacher, Mr. Zhao. Mm-hmm. Mr. Zhao begins his class, "Friends, I'm so glad you're joining us today. Let's all settle in for a minute in silence in each other's presence." And for a minute, they sit there in silence.
Oh my God, that's amazing.
And they meditate for 60 seconds. Mm-hmm. "Thank you. I'm glad we're all here today. Let's begin."
And he has them just in the palm of his hand.
If I took those same kids because of who I am, if I tried that, they'd be making fart sounds.
They'd be laughing at me.
Yeah, they'd get the giggles and boogers would fly out because they know it. I'm faking it. But that's who this dude, he really is, like Mr. Buddha, you know, all centered and present, and it's amazing.
It's so cool. Well, he's practicing something in the classroom, too, that is a bigger conversation that's been happening that I'm glad, and I'm eager to hear more and more people talk about it, but mindfulness in the classroom.
Yeah.
And, you know, so pro tip for teachers, like apps like Headspace and Calm, which are expensive subscription services, are giving it away for free.
Yeah, I was about to say, expensive to teachers.
It's, you know, and I think because everybody's starting to recognize that our kids are really just, they're struggling. Like, there's so much pressure on them and anxiety, and they're really struggling. And so I love that he does that because he brings that mindfulness into the classroom, and they're so eager for it. They want that. And so that, but yeah, if I, and you know, and I do some mindfulness things with them and stuff, but if I did that every day, they'd be like, "Did she go to like a yoga retreat?"
Hey, enough. Okay. Were you in your midlife crisis? Can we just,
she's having an existential crisis. What's happening? I mean, cause if I'm not like over here, like, you know, doing some weird dance move because it embarrasses them, then they're like, "Is she sad? Is she okay?"
Clearly she's having a problem.
It's not a good
thing. Yeah, the closest I got with my last teaching assignment over at Cy Springs, we do PALs, and oftentimes I can't remember, maybe my last couple of years there, it was all seniors. Mm-hmm. And I could tell they're overwhelmed, and it's finals or end of course exams, and they're applying for scholarships, and they're trying to graduate, or, you know, it's opposite ends of the spectrum. One kid's trying to get hours to pull off a graduation. Other kids are trying to apply for scholarships and trying to maybe, you know, compete for the top spot. And they've been in class periods. We just shut it down. We turn off the lights. And what I would do, I get like a half dozen balloons and blow them up. Uh-huh. I put on the music, you know, some ballads. And we all lay on our back on the floor, on the carpet. Uh-huh. And we just, anytime the balloon comes in, you just keep it pop, just pop it up.
Oh, I love that.
And we just zone out for 30 minutes. You know?
I love that. I love that.
It's so relaxing.
I do that a couple of times. I love the balloon idea. Don't do that. But especially with my yearbook and newspaper kids, there'll be a week where they're real snappy with everybody and with me and with each other and outside the classroom. And you could just tell things are just not going well. And it's always surrounding that testing and, you know, season and all that kind of stuff. And we'll just turn the lights out and I'll play soft music and I let them take a nap. And I know that, you know, lots of people would be like, "Well, you're losing instructional time." Actually, I'm gaining a ton of instructional time because what I'm doing is now I'm not having to fight this heavy cloud that's in my classroom. And what shocks me is the last time I did it, I saw a couple kids that cried. Like, they just laid there and they just cried. And
letting it go.
Letting it go. And they just needed someone to recognize that their tiny little bodies are just out of control. You know, their minds are struggling and they're unhappy and they're stressed. And they just needed somebody to say, it's totally okay right now.
Yeah.
To not be okay. And to just take a few minutes. And, you know, and then at the end I say, okay, well, you know, let's go ahead and get back up, you know. And then there'd be a couple of kids who'd still be asleep and I would just let them sleep.
Yeah.
You know, just let them finish this time of rest that they need. And we only do this like once, maybe twice a year, but it's always been effective for me. And people sometimes ask me, well, how do you do this? Like, what's your process? I'm like, well, I first turn out the lights.
Yeah. I said, everybody shut it down.
Yeah. And then I turn on some music.
Yeah.
And then I stop talking, you know, and that's what I do.
Yeah. That's it. You know, I think sometimes we forget that, you know, relatively speaking, this is for a kid, this might be their most stressful point of their life they've ever experienced. For a teacher, in that teacher's world, it wouldn't even make the list of even a memory. Because maybe this is a teacher where her spouse is in the oil and gas industry here in Houston. And because prices have plummeted, there's a risk of them getting laid off. And they live month to month like everybody. Mm-hmm. And they're trying to figure out how they're going to pay their mortgage. We might have to move out and rent an apartment and try to sell our house. Or is it going to get foreclosed on? And we can't afford to get the car fixed. And it rattles when it drives. There's so much going on. The kid has ADD and they need to get tested. And their own child. I mean, there's so much is happening.
Yeah.
What that kid has experienced in their world, that's not even a stress, man. That's not even that's not in the parking lot of the reality of stress. But for that kid, it's their entire world crumbling down on them.
Yes.
And they're at the same place.
Yeah. Well, and I think America too is, there's articles about this out there that we have this culture of busy and we have this culture of trying to compete with busyness. And we also have this mentality that all stress is not equal. Just because stress is different doesn't mean it can't be equal.
Yeah.
And teachers are incredibly stressed out. Like we are, but there's just so much. I mean, what was that? I saw a headline the other day that teachers make 1,000 decisions a day at least, you know? So yes, it's stressful, but just because your stress is different doesn't mean it's not equal.
Yep.
And we, like you said, we may look at some of their stress and go, that's trivial, you know, but it's not to them.
No, it's everything.
It's not to them.
In that busy culture, and since you've traveled and you have you're the kid from your town that has a passport.
Yeah.
and you've gone to Europe or whatever, I've been to France a few times, a number of times. And the way I've go is because we've been able to cash in all of my airline miles. And at the time we had a friend who had a house there.
Yeah.
So it was like, we got this trip and when we're there and like the whole goal of France is you wake up late in the south of France and you try to find food. So you go forage little villages, you have to go to the butcher and you go to the cheese guy, then you go to the wine guy and you find a vegetable guy and the fish guy, and it takes all day to find this food. Then you come back, you take a little nap, you hang out, you relax, and you start cooking around 8 o'clock, start eating around 9:30, and that's the whole day.
Yeah.
And what I realize every time, I think, man, these people have it figured out. These people are living, this is how you're supposed to live. And this is what I'm committing. This is how I'm going to run my life. And then I'm convinced of it for 2 weeks. And then we land at International Airport and we're coming down 45 South and there's the billboards and my phone's beeping for 2 weeks of messages and they're not coming through. And I'm back in. I'm back into the American hustle.
It's one person can't change all of it. And, you know, I think that we all deal with that, especially if you've traveled overseas and you've seen the way other countries approach things that we think, well, I'm going to come home and I'm going to do that. But then you would have to buy in from everybody to be able to change up, because I can't tell my boss, well, actually, I shut it down at contract time and I don't do anything else. Right. Like they'd be like, say what?
Right.
Like, then can come again. And you just can't do that. And, you know, I think it's even in France. I want to say it's France that the drivers can only drive for a certain amount of time in one stretch where they have to stop legally and take a break. I don't remember if it's 2 hours or 4 hours, but like they have to stop.
Yeah.
And it's I feel like those countries put so much emphasis on personal health for their citizens.
Yeah.
And we just don't do that. We don't do that here.
And even when they stop, they know how to do it right.
Yeah.
Like they don't have, there's no to-go cups at the coffee shop.
No.
They don't have to-go cups. You sit down, you talk to the people that are having coffee. You strike up a conversation.
Read the newspaper.
Yeah. And you chit-chat. Then you get back on the road.
Hey, listen, we stopped at a gas station in Germany, which we called it like the German Buc-ee's because it was so nice. And we had schnitzel there. It was the best schnitzel I've ever had in my life because it was like a full service restaurant inside this gas station. And it was like, there were tons of families like, and they're eating and stuff like that. And it was like, well, this is very common that gas stations aren't these in and out kind of things. People stop and they eat and things like that because they don't push themselves to the absolute limit. And you know, it's, we're overworked.
Yeah.
We're underappreciated, and in that we actually compete. Like you sit down and have a conversation with people, and you're like, "Wow, I was just so busy this week." Like,
you think you're busy? Let me tell you what I did.
Yeah. Oh my God. You know, I'm so sorry that you know you had to like give 3 proposals this week. Blah, blah, blah. But listen, what I did, and it's like, are we competing for who's busiest? Because no one wins here. Like everyone is losing.
That's the whole hashtag hustle. Lifestyle.
Hustle and grind.
Yeah.
You know, and
as if we're going to celebrate it and put it on a shirt.
Well, and I was that person that would like have shirts that like coffee cups say hustle, you know, and all this kind of stuff. And it's only been within the last couple of years that I've thought the hustle is literally taking years off my life.
Yeah.
It's I'm unhealthy physically, mentally, spiritually, emotionally, because I'm hustling so hard and really for what? Because would my students notice if I took a Saturday to relax? No, they wouldn't notice. And furthermore, if I were to tell them, well, I could either grade your papers or relax and take care of myself, they would say, you should probably relax.
Yeah, just relax. Here, I'll grade my paper.
Yeah, they're like, oh, they love to grade papers. It's so weird. I'm like, no, you can grade your own paper. But no, it's we're overworked.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And man, that's every industry.
I think that's where the affirmation comes into, because we were talking about how teachers love to be affirmed, and you speaking about how critically important that is. Like, I can't, you know, here's my I got a lot of theories on a lot of stuff.
I like it.
All right, here's one.
Most of mine are conspiracy theories, so I appreciate it.
Here's one of them is I think this is where we really fall short, is providing teachers with the evidence that it's working. And what I mean by that is, you know, teachers don't sign up for this for the paycheck.
Nope.
So, and they don't sign up for this for the data, and they don't sign up for this to necessarily deliver the content. No one says, why did you become a teacher? Because I want to fill a kid's noggin with as much mathematical information as possible. No one ever says that. Like, they would say, I want to be the person that has this monumental influence on the life of a kid. But nowhere do I find, I shouldn't say nowhere, rarely do I find schools that are providing evidence for their educators that that's really happening.
Yeah.
And because we don't have evidence that it's working, that's where we start to burn out, and we start to get into that downward spiral of toxicity on this kid. You know, because we don't see that it's working, because that's a really hard subjective thing to see and approve. And that's why I just beg principals, man, put kids, if you're having a faculty meeting, you need to have 5 kids there talking about the difference that's making, that's happening in their lives because of a teacher that's sitting in that room right now.
That's huge.
Like at the end of the, be the one thing. That's why we do that, is when kids stand up and they talk to a teacher. And on the card it says, you've made a difference in my life by, and I asked them to give a specific example, not because you're there for me. No, man, like, tell me what happened when they were there for you. What did they say to you? Because of that, I'll never forget the day that we went into the hallway and you looked me in the eye and you told me that when I grow up, like, that's the moment, because that's what teachers are signed up for. And rarely are they getting an opportunity to experience a payday. That's the payday.
That is the payday for sure, because that is what we're paying teachers with, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, we're not, we have a lot, especially now, there's a lot of conversations about equal pay for teachers or I don't even know if equal pay is the right term or
appropriate
pay, you know, because a lot of the pay is inappropriate.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't ask people to work like this and not pay them a wage that, that affirms what they're doing. So that is the payday. Absolutely. And I love that you said like a specific moment, because so many times teachers just do things that are in their nature and they never realize what a difference
it makes.
They're
numb to it.
They have no idea. I don't know of any teacher teacher that I'm close with that wakes up every morning and thinks, you know, I'm going to do this and then it's going to change this kid's life and then they're going to love me forever and then da da da.
Right.
you just wake up and you say, you know, you say whatever mantra you need to get through the day. Mine is always, you know, I just want to know them better and love them more.
Yep.
Like that's all I want today. I want to know them a little bit better and I want to love them a little bit more. And then when a kid comes back and says, you know, you did this, and you're like, I didn't even realize I did that. Like,
here's a perfect example of that. There was a photo that went viral of a male teacher in elementary school. He's on his knees hugging a kid, and the kid is having a meltdown. Uh-huh. It's not a video, but you can just see by the, I know how kids look, because I have kids. Mm-hmm. When they're in the deepest, darkest moment of the meltdown, and tears and boogers and a kid's face is, you know, and there's this a gentleman hugging this teacher. I'm hugging the kid, just lovingly holding the kid while this is happening. And the thing gets a million views, and oh my God, this is magical and whatever. And I was talking to our principal, Travis Niemeyer, up in North Dakota. Sorry, brother. Montana, somewhere, one of those states. And he was talking about, like, he has pictures on his phone of that exact same picture with his teachers. And
yeah.
And this is just a daily thing that happens. And, like, we're numb to that. And then I read an article about that teacher. And here's what I love. In there, he said, I don't even remember that.
No.
Because this is what you do.
He does that every day, probably.
Yeah.
Every single one of those kids in his class could probably say, well, yeah, I had that moment too.
Yeah. And for it's a viral, and I think that's the one of our faults as educators. We don't take time to help each other recognize the magic that's happening.
Well, and I think that there's a really, there's a conversation we had about these viral moments as well, that how much are we pushing teachers to have a viral moment? You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I think that there's a conversation even to be had about what we could define as famous educators,
right?
You know, and the pressure even on them to somewhat shoulder the weight of the entire public image of teachers.
Yeah.
You know, I love when these teaching moments go viral, of course, because it brings to light how valuable teachers are and what they do. But what happens, though, is now we start getting these education superstars, these famous educators, and they're great teachers. They deserve where they're at. But now we expect them to carry the entire weight of the public image of education. And then we start pushing people to do things that start, you know, it's this whole social media push with teaching, teaching too. Please share that. And it's not that we're always hoping things go viral, but we're doing it because we're trying to prove to the public that we're valid. Because at the end of the day, I'm going to take a hot take, and somebody's probably not going to like it. The public doesn't value teachers as much as they say they do.
I think we have enough evidence to...
Yeah, I think we have enough evidence to show that. It's monetary, whatever.
Right.
But, you know, it's kind of like there's a meme that went around. It was like of a pill bottle, and it's like hard to swallow pills or whatever. And it was like, but on it was like, it has stuff written so people change all the time. But it's like one of them is like, you're not as nice as you think you are.
Right.
And I want to like almost re-edit it and say, you don't really care about education as much as you think you do. And because we're looking for these feel-good moments from teachers, but we have no tolerance for when they have to be tough.
Yeah.
And we have no tolerance for whenever things don't go perfectly. Like if a school doesn't make a perfect decision, or if we don't tell you about picture day quick enough or whatever, we're going to take to social media and completely blast you. And so educators and educational leaders are running this race of trying to prove that they are doing good with kids and that they're valuable and worthy of appreciation by sharing out everything all the time. It's becoming this public image race that I'm all for social media, don't get me wrong, but we shouldn't have to beg people to believe that we're valid and valuable.
Yeah.
And I get a little bit on my soapbox about that all the time, that I'm like, I don't ask a sanitation worker to post what they're doing every day with a specialized hashtag or anything like that for me to super appreciate what they do. I appreciate them because they do something that is valuable and needed to keep our infrastructure working. And they do a really hard thing that people don't often affirm them for.
Yeah.
So why are we not just trusting the classroom teachers doing a great job? You know,
it's so true. And in the, man, there's so much to that. You know, I think, you know, just having that tool of Facebook
as
a tool for express your opinion,
mm-hmm.
And then because you want people to actually pay attention, I think the natural response is for a person that's going to talk about education and teachers, well, I have to make it as salacious as possible. Or else it's just going to get, no one's going to read it.
Yeah.
And I want people to read it and comment. Mm-hmm. That's what they're thinking, or consciously or subconsciously. And so, like, I need to bring attention to a situation that's happening in the classroom or in the hallway or something that's been posted. Mm-hmm. And even if it's something negative, you know, I've seen these things where, like, I do like to watch it too. Like, you know, I don't know if you remember, it was in somewhere in Dallas area, Plano maybe, where it was a kid. He was a homeschool kid, went back to school. He's a tall kid. He's got little beautiful, beautiful long blonde hair. Uh-huh. And he's yelling at the teacher, "You need to get up from your desk. You need to teach from your heart."
Yeah.
You remember that? And people wanted me to comment on it. And I still to this day haven't, because I don't know what happened in that classroom. I don't know. Maybe there's, I know more to the story now. I don't know if it's true, but maybe the kid has been, I'm not saying he has, but what if a kid has been aggressive in the past and a teacher sitting there passively at the desk would have been the best response to that?
Yeah.
Calmly saying, "Please leave." That's all she did, was saying, "Just please leave."
Yeah.
And he's yelling back at her. I don't know. You just pass out works. I don't know if they just pass out works. I don't know if her department chair has assign them teachers to pass out worksheets. I don't know anything, man.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to comment on that. Or there's a video of a teacher or assistant principal. It was like a black and white kind of hallway cam, her dragging like a fourth grader or fifth grader by the arm down the hall. And people went crazy about this.
Yeah.
I don't know what kind of violence ensued from that child prior to that. Yeah. I don't know. Our class is about to change in 30 seconds and kids are going to pour into this hallway. And now she's got this kid out there.
She's making a snap decision to get this kid to safety.
I don't know. So I don't comment on, because I have no idea. Does it look bad? Of course it looks bad.
Yeah.
But I don't know.
There's a lot of things that look bad. Yeah. Like whenever you just catch 20 seconds of a 20-minute interaction and we base opinions off 20 seconds. And we think that that 20 seconds is the truth and it's the reality, and that's not fair.
Mm-mm.
And also because there is a mentality of those who can't do teach. People still think that all the time. They think that, which was hard for me when I became a teacher. Cause when you want to be a journalist and now you're teaching journalism, and I struggled with it for a long time, and I will, you know, I don't anymore, because what I do is really valuable for the journalism industry. But it took me a long time to get there. And it was because I encountered people all the time that had this mentality of those who can't do teach. So when they see things like that, they revert back to this inner judgment that they have and allow it to dictate their response. And they make statements like, "Well, I would never do that if I was a teacher." Well, until you're managing 140 kids every day.
Yeah.
With a million different things happening, you can't say that, because you really don't know. You don't know what you would do. We have to stop also living in hypotheticals. You can't live like that.
Right.
And the internet is full of shoulds and coulds and woulds. And it's like, okay, well, you continue to live in hypothetical situations where you know, all you can say is, "I would hope that I wouldn't do that," or "I would hope that I would make a better judgment," or "I would hope that the entire video came out so that people could see the reality."
Right,
and not that, you know, but people make snap judgments all the time.
It's even not just the entire video. It's the months and months that came before that led up to that moment.
Yeah.
There's so much. It's all so layered. And you know, the need for like the lack of appreciation, you know, because remember, this is the one, we always say, you know, it's the one profession that teaches the rest of the professions. Yeah. And the leaders of tomorrow are sitting in our classrooms today. And even more than that, this is one of those professions where it's a completely different every day. Mm-hmm. There's no, man, I get it. Like if you're an accountant, well, maybe the laws change every once in a while and you got to adjust or whatever. Or you have an interesting new client with a personality. But we're talking about 140 pre or post-pubescent.
Yeah. Just skin bags of hormones. Yeah. Like,
it's crazy.
Yes. Because you also don't just have those 140 kids. You have their parents essentially in that room. Yeah. You have their siblings. You have their bosses, because I don't know. I mean, every single day I'm having conversations with different kids about this interaction with mom, this interaction with dad, this interaction with a boyfriend, this interaction with a girlfriend, this interaction with a boss.
Yeah.
Like, so all of those personalities are also in my classroom all the time, because sometimes I'm undoing really terrible advice that's been given to them. And sometimes I'm affirming great things that have done for the, that have happened for them. And it's that, that's what people don't realize. I'm not just teaching content. I'm a relationship counselor.
Right.
I'm a family counselor. You know, it's, I'm proofreading college essays, you know, it's just a million things. So yeah, it's this tiny snippet of a video you think completely encompasses that teacher's entire life in the classroom. And almost always there are kids that come out afterwards and say, that person's a really good teacher. And that kid causes a lot of problems. Or they had a bad moment. That wasn't the whole story. We always hear afterwards, that wasn't the whole story.
Yep. I think because of teaching, when I hear anything about anybody, well, I don't know, man.
I don't know the whole story.
Nope. I don't like, you know.
Or I'll say, wow, that sounds really bad on the surface.
Yeah.
I wonder what else happened.
I don't know. Yeah, because here, you know, the other thing is, and I can flip-flop back and forth on this, is, you know, we talk about, you know, I need to be a relationship counselor, and I need to be a family counselor, and I need to be sometimes a food provider.
Yeah.
You know, and on and on and on, and a medical help seeker so that I can deliver my content. And you know what? I can get there, but I can also see a lot of times, and it's completely opposite. I'm using my content as the vehicle so that I can put myself in an opportunity to change this kid's life by counseling with them in terms of their family and their friends and their relationships and their financial situation and their food. You know, like, that's the point. Like, you know, I want to deliver the content, but more so than that, the reason I'm in there, you know, I guess I like the content. It's cool.
Yeah.
But the reason I'm there is to change a kid's life.
Right. Well, and that, I love that you said that, that it's like, yeah, the content's cool, but it's all about the relationships. Because that's also something we have to realize about Gen Z learners. They don't need us in a lot of ways.
Right.
They have something called the internet, which is access to all information. If any kid had enough tenacity and had YouTube and a willing volunteer, they could probably learn how to perform open heart surgery.
Yep.
Like they could YouTube enough things to teach themselves how to do it.
Yeah.
So I think that as educators, we also have to have a really honest conversation with ourselves about what our role in the classroom is. And we are there to help them learn, and we are there to help facilitate learning. But I think if I ever take a moment where I think, well, I am the most knowledgeable person in this room, whoa, I need a reality check because these kids are often so much smarter than me. And the one thing I truly have on them is life experience.
Yeah.
And so the thing I can really bring for them is wisdom and to listen to what's happening in their lives and to help them work through where to go next. Yeah. Because I really honestly don't know that I've ever had a student that was like, I learned so much about journalism. You know what I mean? Like, they've said nice things like that. But the majority of them talk about the relationships that we build.
That's all story. Yeah. I'll never forget the time that, yeah.
Yeah, like that's what they'll do. So that's always my message to teachers as well, is that you, especially now, and this has been a recent kind of, you know.
It takes a while.
It takes a while to get there to where I was like, wow, they really don't need me.
Yeah.
In a lot of ways. They do need me, but they don't need me in the way that I once thought.
Yeah.
And that I'm here to help them learn how to learn, and I'm here to give them the opportunity to learn and give them a guidance on where to go. But it's wisdom. They need my wisdom.
You know where it's changed for me in I've believed it for a long time because I'm way older than you, but when you attach of money to it, it changes. For example, my daughter now goes to college.
Yeah,
it's been there for 2 weeks. And when you can attach, you know, $15,000 to $20,000 a year to this lesson, because college is so preposterous at this point.
Oh my gosh.
Because like her and all of her little nerdy friends that are all crazy talented and crazy smart and crazy resourceful, you could put that kid in a fourth or fifth year in a graduate economics class, give him the final, let her use her phone. I guarantee she makes an A. Mm-hmm. Guarantee it.
Yeah.
So like, what's the point of the whole thing? So that's why I always get back in everything I do with those teachers when I'm in front of them is like, what is the real lesson, man? Like, what do you want for those kids as a result of them spending their lives with you when they're at the reunion 40 years from now and they're talking about you? Mm-hmm. What do you want them to say? Because all the content you taught them, not only are they going to forget it, it doesn't even matter if they remember it, because it's not going to apply to them in 40 years of technology.
Everything will have changed.
Yeah. So that none of that even mattered. Like, what is the one lesson you want as a result of your class? Like, that is so critical. And then, you know, the other thing is, you know, like, though they do, man, they have access to, like, I was telling my son, hey, brother, like, he was wanting to learn something. Listen, at this point, if you suck, it's your own fault. A tutorial for everything.
Yes, I could learn how to do anything. Yeah. My sister's the queen of YouTube too. Like, she'll often just tell me like things she learned how to do on YouTube, and I'm just like, "Is that all you do?" And she's like, "That's fun." But it's, I mean, you know, I'm not gonna reveal her age. Actually, she would come for me, but I'm not gonna do that. But she's older than me, and it's even how we learn now.
Yeah,
you know, it's learning has completely changed. They could learn anything they needed to on the internet.
It's so true.
No, there's no special website that's like blocked off for them that they, you know, that's like, well, here's actually the access to all learning. You know what I mean? Like, was it Harvard put out all of their photography
right.
lessons? You know, it's so then it begs the question even of, why does this kid need to go to Harvard if yeah. you're going to share all your lessons? If a kid's tenacious enough. So, I mean, that even gets in the conversation of, and I'm going everywhere, but. You know, we often hear kids say, well, I want to get into a good college. The quality of an educational institution matters very little if you're not someone who takes every opportunity
yeah.
that's handed to you. And that's how it is with learning. I think we have to teach kids how to take opportunities.
Yeah.
And to be tenacious.
And, you know, when my daughter was graduating, because of the high school she went to, it's very, they just have a culture and a tradition of going to these name schools. Mm-hmm. And so these kids are doing auditions at Carnegie Mellon and NYU and all these places like that.
Yeah.
And I'm begging her, like, find the people you love and you want to live with for 5 or 6 or 7 years.
Yes.
Not 4, because I mean, come on.
Take as much time. All these kids are, I want to finish college in 3 years. I'm like, why?
That's my biggest. Everybody says, do you have any regrets? Yeah, I got 2 of them. One yeah. is I really wish I just had a job. I didn't do it 4. I just went mm-hmm. and had a job and took 12 hours instead of 20 or uh-huh. 18. And I had a little job and I relaxed and I had more fun.
Yeah.
For whatever reason, I think I was so just not successful in high school, but I just went crazy in college trying to get it done, trying to get the mm-hmm. student teaching so I can get out and get a job. And by the way, I had no business teaching anybody's children at age 22.
Me either.
And why did I just go take the extra 3 years and just relax, yes. man?
College should be 6 or 7 years, because it's also the only time in your life where you're really given a free pass.
Yeah.
Where you're really, it's an incubator kind of environment of adulthood, but you're still very protected. So I think that's the biggest thing for colleges. We're teaching them how to be an adult,
yeah.
which is not an easy concept to learn. But we have some kids that rush through it. It's like, stop rushing through it. Enjoy it. Have a good time, because this fun stuff doesn't exist. I don't want to be like that to him, but it's like, it all goes downhill after
it
that. Like,
goes
no,
away.
It, there's other good stuff on the other side of it, but it's very different.
Yeah.
It's very different good stuff. And so, yeah, don't rush through college.
I used to see those guys that had like 3 degrees and now either starting as a music major and this dude like he's 40. You know, I see him at the river every time, and he has yeah. his beard down to his belly button. I'm thinking, what a freaking loser. That dude had it figured out.
Yeah, he did. He really evaluated life and yeah. was like, no. This is how you're supposed to live it.
Yeah, he could play hacky sack like nobody's business.
If I could grow a beard down to my belly button and go back.
Yeah.
Man, no, I was like, and you often hear adults like, what do you miss most? Like, college. They'll say, I miss college. I miss college so much. And it's like, well, why did we miss it? Because it was free, like in a lot of ways. Like we got to make mistakes that didn't yeah. ruin our lives. We got to hang out with our friends and, you know, and learn stuff that we chose to learn and have choice. And yeah, so
right.
every adult's like, I miss college.
Yeah, even the big mistakes.
Yeah.
I can get those expunged.
Yeah. Sorry, what? What happened? I don't remember that at all.
Right?
You can't prove that it happened. Yeah. It's not on my record anymore.
Hey, listen, man. Thank you so much. I love our time. We're going to do it again. I think we're going to do a few or 5 or 10, 20 more of these.
Let's do it.
Me and you.
This is fun.
It's amazing.
I love to talk, though. Like a story, storytelling, you know.
Yeah.
And that's why people love podcasts, because it's like you get to sit in on somebody's conversation.
That's what somebody told me about mine. He goes, she told me, I feel like I'm in the back seat of your car, and you and your friend are up in the front seat, and you don't know I'm in the back seat, and you're just talking.
We could absolutely have a web series like that. You know, it's like just, you know, you come ride in a car with us.
Right.
We just sit and talk. Every once in a while, we'll shout a question back to you, like, hey, what do you think?
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much. We'll do it again. I appreciate you.
I appreciate you.
You're amazing. Up top.
Up top.
Talk.